Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua-Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Would you grab your Bibles and turn to 1 John chapter 2 as we get ready to seat the Lord in this passage? I pray truly that your eyes would be enlightened from the things what John is going to write here to help strengthen your faith. I know these words have helped my faith, and I just pray that this morning the words that I share will somehow convey those things of strength to your faith. 1 John chapter 2, we're going to pick up where we left off last week. We got through verse 17. It says that this world is passing away, and also in this world, it's working just now. Thank you, Lord. So in 1 John chapter 2, verse 15, we read last week, do not love this world nor the things of this world. Because if anyone loves the world, it says the love of the Father is not in him. We've already looked at that. But you know, it's Jesus said, you can't love mammon or riches of this world and serve them and serve God. He says you're going to have to choose, which master do you serve? You either cling to one and hate the other, or vice versa, cling to the other and hate the opposite one. You have to choose. Who will you serve? Will you serve God in this life, or will you serve riches, money? Because money does become a god. I mean, it's an idol to folks, is sometimes some of the things that many people have gone astray. In fact, the Bible actually teaches us that is the love of money, not money itself, the love of money is the root of what? Of all evil. Sorry, when I look over to you guys, there's some cars in the parking lot blinding me. I was going to try to leave my glasses off, but I'll be cool. Whew, that's better. It's the love of money, you know, and the Bible gives us very clear instructions in the Ten Commandments. The very first commandment tells us that God, in Exodus 20, is a jealous God. And he says, I want you to have how many other gods before me? No other gods, none, zero. Including, if you would make riches your God, that's having another God before him. You can't serve God and money. Now, you can seek God first. Like Jesus taught us in Matthew 6, seek ye first his kingdom, his righteousness, and how many things of what we need will be added to us? By the way, this is how many things of what you need, not what you want. Okay, I know there's a lot of false teachers saying this is the key how to get everything you want. Let me tell you, it's the key of how to get through this life for what you need, because we have a very faithful God who supplies our needs. Sometimes he doesn't give you your wants because you don't even understand, you know, that your wants might corrupt you. And he knows that. So he'll give you what you need, truly what you need. And sometimes, if you can receive this, I've shared this before, but sometimes he will not give you certain things because he knows that, well, those things could really get you in a bad way. And I tell people, they say, but I lack so many different things. And I think, no, you're just free from so many different distractions. You know, your lack of provision, if you can receive it, is actually God's provision for your life to let you be able to focus better on the quality of life you have rather than the distraction of all this busyness. You know, sometimes people that have a lot, they're consumed with taking care of all their stuff, and they don't realize that they have come to have to serve a different master. And Jesus wants us to be free to serve our Heavenly Father. Let him be our master. Follow him in what he... Jesus said, I only do the things I see the Father do. I only say the things what I hear the Father saying. I want to be like that. When I'm so busy having to fix the broken refrigerators and the you know, stuff that breaks. Like, why do they build obsolescence into stuff now? By the way, my fridge ice maker, you know, it went out 1 week past the warranty. 1 week, the warranty expired. The guy, when I called, they said, if it would have just happened 2 weeks ago, we could take care of this for you. But your warranty has expired. They build those things to, they tell some guy, make this thing fail 1 week after the warranty. You know? I'm sure of it. Anyone think that there's a conspiracy? Snap? Yeah, that's for sure. Right? Amen? They do that. And these things can become a distraction. A true distraction to the things that are really essential to our faith. So what does John tell us? This is the thought we ended last week with, and I want to pick up here. But to pick up, I really need to put your mind in the right spot. John's got us to the point where he says, do not love this world, nor the things of this world. Because look at verse 15 with me, would you? Do not love this world, nor the things of the world. For if anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in this world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the boastful pride of life, those things are not from the Father. Those things are from this world. And he says, and this world is passing away, and also all of its lusts. But the one who does the will of God, this is how far we got last week. The one who does the will of God, he'll abide for how long? Forever. Now this is where we're beginning today. If you're willing to do God's will, you will abide. That means you'll remain forever. We're going to see more details what he means, but sometimes people go, I don't get that. I said, don't stop reading. It's self-explanatory. You just got to read a little farther in the chapter. In fact, it's spelled out for us. Let me just read it to you. He says, children, it's the last hour. And just as you have heard that the Antichrist is coming, even now, he said, many Antichrists have appeared. For from this we know that this is the last hour. They went out from us, but they were not really of us. For if they had been of us, they would have remained with us. But they went out so that it would be shown that they are not of us. Now, this is in the days of the early church, John's writing this. And he's saying, already they had guys that were Antichrists. I mean, they had the true Messiah right there. Jesus said, or John said, we witnessed him, we saw him, we touched him, we've seen the true, genuine article. But he uses something really interesting. He says, he identifies, we're in the last hour. You know, when I think of last hour, like, if someone said, you're in the last hour, the last, what, you're coming down to the wire. You know, we're in the last hour of what? Of this age. And he's describing one of the ways he knew it was the last hour is because all these guys were showing up and they were against Christ, the Antichrist. And by the way, some people say, I don't understand it. What's the answer when you don't understand? Quit reading, right? Put it away. It's too difficult. No. Let me show you the answer when you don't understand. In fact, John knew as he wrote this, he's a true pastor, that there's going to be people that don't understand these things. So he's going to give you the answer of how to understand. Let me show it to you this morning. This is one of the, truly one of the best things I could get to share with you this morning. He says right here, but you have an anointing from the Holy One. And you all know. He says, and I've not written to you because you do not know the truth, but because you know the truth, because you do know that truth, he says, and because there is no lie in the truth. You know, when you know the truth, Jesus says, if you know the truth will set you what? Free. And John says, you have an anointing. What's that anointing he's talking about that they had? The Holy Spirit. You have the Holy Spirit. Now he says, who is a liar but the one that denies that Jesus is the Christ? He said, this is the Antichrist. If someone denies that Jesus is the Savior of the world, the one God sent, Christ, the Savior is what it translates to in English, Mashiach in the Hebrew, Messiah, one sent to save us from our sin. If someone says, Jesus isn't the one sent to save us from our sins, John would say they are what? They got the spirit of the Antichrist. Right there, that identifies them right there. And this is the one that denies the Father and the Son. Verse 23, whoever denies the Son, he says, does not have the Father. And whoever confesses the Son has the Father also. Now, as for you, let that abide in you which you have heard from the beginning. And if what you have heard from the beginning abides in you, you also will abide in the Son and in the Father. If you will just, guys, but to understand, the one that confesses the Son has the, he has the Father. Now, what if they don't confess the Son? Would they say, yeah, I believe in God, but I don't believe in Jesus. Have you ever heard anyone say that, by the way? I believe there's a God, but I'm not into the Jesus thing. John would say, verse 23, you might want to highlight this as an answer to someone. Whoever denies the Son, he says, does not have the Father. You can't get the Father without the Son. It's a package deal. In fact, they told Jesus, could you just show us the Father? And what was his answer? Have I been with you so long a time? Have you seen me? You have what? Seen the Father. I came to show you the Father. And they were like, just show us the Father, and it will suffice. And he's going, duh. Like, wake up. You guys remember in John chapter 10, was about verse 30, he tells the Pharisees, I and the Father are what? One. He doesn't try to make it a mystery. He's like, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. I came to show you the Father. I'm on the mission. And his mission is, Jesus said, I came to do his commandment. And his commandment in John's gospel, not here in 1 John, in John's gospel, he says that God's commandment to Jesus was one thing. Do you guys know what his commandment was? It's actually two words it writes in John's gospel. Everlasting what? Four-letter word, play hangman. Life. He said his command was, I bring everlasting life. Anyone want everlasting life? He said, that's what I'm here to do. I just came to be the one to give everlasting life. The Father commanded it. He wanted men to have everlasting life. That's why I'm here. And just to let you know, look at verse 25. And this is the promise which he himself has made. What's the promise? Two words? Same two words, what? Eternal life. Everlasting life. This is God's command, his promise. You know, when people say, why are you Christians so big into this Jesus and God stuff? I go, how's everlasting life sound? You know, by the way, some Christians, they don't know to actually default to what Peter calls the hope. The hope, what we have. When people say, you know, why are you really into this whole God trip? And I'm like, do you think you're going to live forever? Because I'm pretty sure there's like 100% mortality rate for everyone down here. Statistically speaking, you're going to die. Now, I'm not trying to be the bearer of bad news. I'm just waking you up spiritually. Like in the book of Ecclesiastes, when Solomon writes, he says, you know, when you consider all life, you can gain all the riches, you can gain all the stuff, and there's still one fact you can't escape. It applies whether you're poor, whether you're rich, whether you're a man of power or fame, or whether you're just a humble, lowly servant. Every one of us have to face this one fact. We're going to die. And when he writes there in the book of Ecclesiastes, he says, you know, it's actually better for you to go to a funeral, a house of mourning, he calls it, rather than to go to a party. Or he calls it a house of feasting. Better to go and be at a funeral than to go to a kegger. I'm just putting modern paraphrase. At least that's what we used to call it in the college days, you know. Better that you would do that. Why? He says it in Ecclesiastes. I don't know if you're familiar with this. He says, because this is the end of every person. When you go to a funeral and you see that person laying there in that casket and you realize, someday I might be, well, there's, yeah, it's pretty much, we don't get out of here without facing that. And the person who looks at that, it says soberly, that it wakes up their spirit. They go, you know, that's the end of everybody. And if that's the end of everybody, I don't know about you, but how many of you think we're really wired for dead? Like we do death really well? we're gracious and no. We're horrible with the whole idea of dying. And Jesus said, I came to give you life. I came to give you life more what? Abundantly. He didn't come to do death. This is the promise, John says, which God himself has made to us. Eternal life. When people say, why are you so into this Jesus? I'm like, because we're talking eternity. And, oh, by the way, I cheated. I read already the Gospel of John. Not here in 1 John, but if you back up to the Gospel of John, Jesus had Lazarus die. And the word had come to him. I referred to this a couple weeks ago. Someone was asking, where is it? So just a quickie for you. Go to John's Gospel. And he had the gals come to him, and they were saying, you know, if you had just been here, Lord, my brother would not have died. Remember Mary and Martha, the sisters of Lazarus? They were like, if you would have just been here, my brother would not have died. And he says to them, well, you know, I am the resurrection and the life. And anyone who believes in me, even if they do die, they don't die, right? They will live. They will live with an everlasting life. And he asked them, do you believe this? And the girls were like, yeah, well, we're trying to. Why weren't you here earlier? I mean, you kind of get from reading it. They understood that he could heal people when they were sick. What they didn't understand that I like to point out is Jesus didn't only do illness or demons or sickness. Jesus did dead. Dead didn't even faze him. You know, like he didn't go, oh my, Lazarus is dead. I can't do anything about it. He's like, all right, show me where you laid him. They take him to the tombs, right? And Jesus, thankfully, Jesus very carefully cried out, Lazarus, come forth, because if he would have just shouted, come forth, in a graveyard, what would have happened? All the graves would have popped open, and he would have just, they would have just come, boom, you know, out walking. You guys realize he had that power to command life even into dead bones. That's the power of God. You know, we read about in the book of Ezekiel that the Lord will cry out to this valley of dead bones, and he'll just speak, and what will happen? When his breath speaks that life to those dead bones, it says the bones will reassemble one to another. They'll get sinew on them. Then the sinew will get muscle. The muscle will get skin. And then the breath of God will do what to those corpses, those dead bodies? What will it do? Bring them back to life. How many believe God can put dead bones back together? He goes, oh, this is really hard. It's like a puzzle. I don't know how to put these little... Wait, was that an ankle bone goes to the shin bone goes to the knee? Wait, do you think it really freaks out the Lord? Well, John chapter 11, Martha said, I know in the resurrection we will rise again on that day. And Jesus said to her, verse 25, this is John 11, 25, I am the resurrection and the life. And he who believes in me, he says, he will live even if he dies. And anyone, he says, everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. How many of you heard that verse? It's a very comforting verse, I think. This is one of the ones, you know, if someone says, why are you really into this Jesus thing? This is why I'm into him. Because I believe in him, and even here, if I was to die, well, it says, he who believes in me will live even if he dies. What is he promising? Life eternal. This is the hope. What Peter says, when someone asks you, why are you a Christian? He said, be ready to give an answer for the hope that lies within your heart. Now, some Christians, I've heard some weird answers. You know, like, why are you a Christian? And they kind of go scattered, hip, skip, scop, you know, little bunny trail here, there. And I'm like, get to the hope. Like, no mention of everlasting life. Like, I'm going to have everlasting life. I'm going to have, like, what Paul writes to the Corinthian church. He says, this body we're living in is a tent. But God has an upgrade. And what did he say? Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you. In my Father's house are many what? Mansions. What does Paul call those new bodies waiting for us? Not made by man's hand, made by a building made by God. And just to let you know, I like his word picture here. You know, because I'm a visual learner. Can you picture a mansion? Like, and I'm not, if Paul calls this body a tent for your spirit, he says God has a building he's making for you, eternal in the heavens. We're upgrading. Anyone want an upgraded body made by God? And just to let you know what he likens it to, this one's the tent, that one's called the what? The mansion. I know some people, they always think of buildings as the mansion. Read the scripture, you'll find out he's talking about a serious upgrade to what we're dwelling in down here. We're going to have bodies that are incorruptible without pain, no more suffering. Anyone up for one of these new models? You know, we were praying for our brother Steve Hudson in our little prayer circle this morning, and I know he would like he knows the hope that we have as believers. We got a promise. John said in 1 John, the promise of God is eternal life. Why don't we just tell people like it is? He promised it. And if they get mad at you, oh, yeah, so holy, talking about eternal life, and you have it. Well, dude, I didn't write this scripture. I'm just telling you what he promised. And if you don't like it, take it up with him. Go ahead, tell him you're mad at him. I'm mad at you. You're trying to give out eternal life. Go ahead, shake your fist at him a little. Can you just be... Imagine your God just watching it going, wow, look at that little one. They're trying to give me eternal life. I don't want it. I won't make you take it. But I... He's really bugging me. You know, have you ever noticed that sometimes people, before they yield their life over to the Lord, they fight a little, they buck a little, they wave their hand. You're so mean. Yeah, he's really a meanie in the sky, isn't he? Trying to give out eternal life. See, the problem why people think he's mean is because they've had a misrepresentation of what he's trying to give. They're not being told the hope that lies within us as believers. When we share the hope that we have, that hope of all of my sins are completely what? Forgiven. Christ came to completely remove my sin and to grant to me everlasting life. If we would just stick to the hope, this is what we're hoping for. People, I think, would go, I need that. They don't need the religious judgment that some people have, this arrogance, this, you know, holier than thou. Any of you experienced the holier than thous? Not a lot of them come here because they look at us and go, you don't dress nice enough. We're not coming to your church. They're already too holy for us. You know, I've had people tell me, you don't wear a tie, Pastor. And we see your knees. Like, you need some slacks. I'm like, God didn't call me to preach in the mainland. He called me to preach on a beach in Hawaii. I'm the most dressed up cat here. Look it. I got my fancy shirt on, buttons and everything. I mean, Art's wearing a T-shirt with a manta ray. And you know what? Does God give a rip what we're wearing? No. Somebody forgot what this whole thing's about. The point. We're talking eternal life, not what we wear. By the way, God does not care what you're wearing. He looks at your heart. Not this external coverings that we've made such a... I mean, people that make a big deal out of what you're wearing, they miss the whole point of what Jesus came to do. They truly have become... blinded by such superficial things that they don't know the depth of that hope, that sweet gift of everlasting life that we're proclaiming. And I think the trappings of this putting on an arrogance, you know, an air to make it like we're so good, we dress this way, and we walk this way, and praise the Lord, you know, and we even know how to vibrato our voice at just the right time. You're so holy. You know? What a hogwash. You think God can't see right through that? He does. And let me show you. John was a pastor for certainly, and exposed to many a sincere believer and insincere. I know that because when I read ahead in this book, I'm like, yeah, some of the reasons he writes, he's going to go on. We went over some of them last week, but there's more to come. In fact, let me just show you this one. Verse 26, here's another reason. You can put a little R next to this for reason. Verse 26, that John says he's writing to us. Now, when I posted our sermon from last week about the reasons that we saw so many of them last week that he wrote, I wrote, isn't it nice to know why the guy is writing? You know, what's his motive? He wants us to know certain things. Let me tell you this one. He says, I've written to you concerning those that are trying to what? Deceive you. He's not hiding the fact that there are guys that try to deceive people. He says, I'm writing because there are those guys out there. And as for you, he says something very comforting. Verse 27, if you don't hear anything else today, please turn your ear to full attention for this verse. He says, as for you, you have the anointing, that anointing which you received from him. And that anointing, it says, abides in you. His spirit, he's talking about. It, abide is a biblical word, what means remains, stays with you. You know that God's spirit stays with you wherever you go? If no one else is around and you try to do something, you know, you're tempted to do something wrong. Have any of you been completely alone? No one's around, and still there was a voice that went, don't do it. Yeah, but no one's here. No one will see. And God goes, I'm here. And I'm not talking about an audible voice. I'm talking about that inner man that says, oh, yeah, by the way, I know some of you have had this experience because you've called me. Oh, pastor, I was all alone the other night, and I was, I don't want to tell anyone, but I was tempted to do something I shouldn't do. And like out of nowhere, it was like this voice in my head. It was not like over the loudspeaker or anything. I'm talking inside speaking to me. Anyone ever experienced this, by the way? The little voice that goes gently, don't do it. Or I wouldn't go there. Or you know, sometimes it's not even that, just a little. You don't even need words when the Spirit is convicting you, right? I mean, can the Spirit convict us? Like we're just about to do something wrong and he's going, mm-mm-mm-mm. And you're like, you scan, no one's around, it's just you. And when people say, prove to me there's a God. Do you know there's not a person on this planet that has not experienced the conviction of the Holy Ghost? Jesus said it in John's Gospel, that God gave his Spirit to convict the world concerning their sin. Every single person in this world has experienced that voice. Now, whether they listen to that, whether they yield when that voice says, don't do it. I mean, some of you are professionals. The voice says no, and you say, I'm doing it anyway. And by the way, if you continue to do that, Paul teaches, what is it? I'm trying to think, what is it? Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians. It's one of those, God eats peaches and cream. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. One of those short epistles. They're referred to in Bible school, the pastoral epistles. But one of those, he says, that if you continue to sin, you sear your conscience. You like put a branding iron to it. You cause it to be seared so that no longer is it tender and able to hear. You know, you can actually just, God could keep saying, don't do it, don't do it. And at first, when you first heard it, it was really loud. Stop. And you almost stopped, but then I'm just going to do it anyway. And again, the voice next time, stop. Yeah, I think I heard that before. Forget it. I'm just going to do. And if you continue to press on and keep doing that sin, what that spirit is saying, don't do, eventually you sear your conscience to the Holy Ghost. You get in a place where even if he was shouting, you don't hear it. You have quenched the Spirit of God. But John knew that God gave that spirit, that anointing, to every believer. His spirit is with all of you, to abide, to remain with you. And let me show you what his spirit John says, now this is not popular to teach today. That's why I say this verse, if you don't get anything else, get verse 27 out of today's sermon. Because this verse, this is the verse hated by all cult leaders. Every cult leader will not teach this verse. Guaranteed. You know why? Let me read it to you. See if you can figure it out. He says, as for you, the anointing which you have received from him, it abides in you. And you have no need for anyone to teach you. But it says, as his anointing teaches you about all things and is true about all things, it says it will not lie. Just as it says, as it has taught you, you abide in him. His anointing teaches you to abide in Christ. The Holy Ghost is the one that gives that anointing. He comes and he says, just stick with Jesus. Abide, remain. It means remain. In fact, if you remain with Jesus, he says, you abide in me, I'll abide what? In you. If you just stay with Jesus, he will stay with you. Now, is that important to teach this next generation? That they need to stick with Jesus? Wherever they go, whatever thing they face in this life, just stay with the Lord. Remain with him. Now, we just studied. You don't love the world, nor the things of the world. Yet, when Jesus prayed this, what's referred to in Bible school as his high priestly prayer, it's actually his prayer. We should call it truly the Lord's Prayer. Is it John 17? He prays for the church. He says, Father, I do not pray that you take them out of this world, right? But that you keep them from the evil one. You're like, what? I'd like it better if you prayed me out of here. That's my commentary on that verse. You know, anyone here thought it'd be nice if the Lord just take us out sometimes? Take me home, Lord. Has anyone had a bad enough day where you've actually prayed that besides me? Like, Lord, this would be a good day. You know, those of you that have faced, you know, chemo or some horrific things your body has gone through suffering, you might be able to identify with me when I say there have been days that death looked like a better friend than living. Because living just meant vomiting and hurting and pain and, you know, dying sounded good. I'm just telling you, that's how bad the pain was. And I got a promise of eternal life. And that sounded really good. When you're in a really bad way, the hope that we have, it becomes even brighter. The darker our circumstance, the brighter that hope becomes. And everlasting life starts sounding really good. But he says, John says, you have an anointing. And that anointing teaches you. Now, why would a cult leader not want me to teach you this verse? It says right here, you have no need for anyone to teach you because who does the job? The Holy Ghost. And see, cult leaders don't want to teach you that you could actually learn everything you need for your walk from God's Spirit. You know, because God's Spirit, is he a good teacher? Does he know how to customize the lesson for each pupil? They say that individualized teaching is the most powerful form of teaching. You know, what I'm doing right now, teaching to a whole group of you, this is not the most effective way to teach. The most effective way to teach is to one-on-one customize the lesson for that individual student. What are you going through? What do you need to know? And who better knows what we need to know than the Holy Spirit of God? He knows exactly what each one of you need. And see, the cult leaders said, don't listen to that. Don't listen to that. You don't need anyone to teach you. We want to teach you. You know, a cult leader's like, I want to be the one that tells you what you got to do, and I'm going to be lording over you, and I'll make sure you do what I say. They don't want you to yield to the Spirit of God leading you. They want to be the one leading you. But a true teacher of the word will point out this verse so that you recognize no matter where you are, no matter if anyone is around, God's Spirit will never, she said, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. Lo, I am with you to the ends of the what? Of the age. I'm going to be with you to the very end. And His Spirit does the sweetest thing. He teaches us whatever we need to know. He's there for us. And He's true. He doesn't lie. Now, little children, listen to verse 28. Abide in Him, so that when He appears, we may have confidence and not shrink away from Him in shame at His coming. If you know that He is righteous, then you know that everyone who practices righteousness is born of Him. Some people have asked me, I don't understand this righteous thing. You know, righteousness in the Bible means to be in right standing with our Maker. It means to be in the right place with Him. And the Bible tells us that our righteousness is as filthy what? Rags. In the Old Testament, that verse is actually the women's time of the month, the menstruation rags, what they called. They say, our righteousness, how great our righteousness is like a menstruation rag. Wow, that sounds great. We're really righteous, aren't we, in our own righteousness? No. Our righteousness is because of Christ. Because of Christ, we are made in right standing with our Creator. And our righteousness is based on what He did, not us. What He performed, not me. He did everything to make me right before God. When He hung on the cross, we studied last week, last three words He said is, it is what? Finished. I paid it all. I have paid the requirement of the law for all their sins. And that's what Christ did. Now He says, little children, abide in Him. So that when He appears. Now, how many believe Jesus is going to come again? I mean, who made up that teaching? No, not made up. Who taught us it? Where did it come from? Jesus. In fact, if you don't like the idea of Jesus' second coming, don't get mad at me. You just shake your little fist at God all you want. I'm mad at you because you came up with this idea that you're sending Jesus again. By the way, I already told you where it was. In John 14, when it says, in my Father's house are many mansions, I go to prepare a place for you. So that, and I didn't finish the verse, but you guys, you want me to finish the rest of it? So that I might come again to receive you to myself, that where I am, you may be what? Also. I want you to be with me. I'm going to go make a place for you. I'm going to be back to get you. Who came up with the idea of Jesus coming back? Jesus. Let me see. Is He credible? Should I trust Him for my theological viewpoints? My doctrinal, you know, foundational truth? Absolutely. If He says He'll be back, He'll be back. And John says, now can you imagine this? When did John write this? First John that we're studying, was this written like 100 years ago, 1,000 years ago? That's right, almost 2,000 years ago. And he thought it was the last hour back then. And people say, you don't really think He's coming soon. I'm telling you, if he thought it was the last hour almost 2,000 years ago, we're in the last minute. Forget hour. Hour almost end. Maybe we should say the last 10 seconds. I don't know how much time we have, but I know that the Scripture says, no man knows the day or the hour of the coming of the Son of Man, except who? The Father. Jesus said, not even the Son knows. Only when the Father tells me, that's when I go. But I'll tell you some signs of the times. They're going to have wars and rumors of wars and pestilence and famines and earthquakes. And these are merely the beginning of birth pangs, like a woman when she goes in travail, how her contractions get stronger and closer together and more intense, and the duration lengthens and the amount of time between shortens. And you know, when a woman goes into labor, her water breaks and you know, for midwives, folks that have been around, you know, hospital folks, they don't go, well, no baby's coming. They know delivery is imminent. In fact, some of these gals that have been around, you know, the births for years, they can look at the woman, they can check a few little indicators, and they'd be like, they can go in the hallway and bet. Like, and they do this. They're like, under 3 hours, she'll be done. You know, no, this one's going to be long. You know, they make like wagers because they know from the intensity of the contractions, the duration between, that they can see the body ramping up, ready for the birth. Here come. Interesting to me, Jesus used that analogy to say, this is the signs that you're going to see in the world. Do we have earthquakes and famines and pestilence and wars? And are they increasing? Did anyone happen to go on Facebook last night and see the one in, was Ecuador? 7.4, bad. Another one in Tokyo. Did you anyone see there was a post that showed with circles all over, it was just a picture of of the map of the world, and it had all these circles, and it said the bigger the circle means the more intense the earthquake was there. And you look down the coasts of South America, I mean, places that haven't had earthquake activity in 1,000 years, and all of a sudden there's like a bunch of dots. And there's big dots. And there's, you go, what's going on? I tell you, Jesus said, you will know the signs of the times. You, when a woman's going into this part of her active labor, we call it, when she's getting ready to give birth, you don't step back and go, ain't going to happen. Baby's never going to get here. Do you act like that? No, this is the time. Hands on deck. Get ready. It's time for a baby. I mean, it's coming. It's not, is it coming? It is coming. We might not know the exact day, the exact minute, but we know one fact. We're in the last hour. We're in that last season. Baby is time for it to come. I submit to you, we're in the last. If John said we're in the last hour back then, we got to be in at least the last minutes. We're getting, how many think we're getting closer to the Lord's return? By the way, just for a quick, the kids were asking me, in the scripture it says the generation what would see this fig tree, you know, reborn, this rebirth, then that generation would not pass away. And that fig tree, we know because we can cheat, we just read the scripture, Hosea. God calls what nation that fig tree that the one he came to look for fruit on? Remember when Jesus went to that fig tree symbolically, right when he's coming into the temple area and he went to get some fruit? He said, there's no fruit. Cursed are you, tree. Don't you know I came to get fruit from you? And what did Hosea call the fig tree? He said, Israel is that fig tree. Now, guys, when this was spoken back then, Israel was a nation. But in 70 AD, if you don't know history, Israel ceased to be a nation. Rome stomped it out. And Israel did not exist as a nation as we know it until 1948. May 17 was the official coronation date. 1948, Israel became a nation once again. So as the generation sees the fig tree come back, that generation doesn't pass away. I'm going to tell you this, but in the Old Testament, a generation was like 100 years. In the New Testament, a generation is only 40 years. So when I first learned this in my early days, you know, 48 plus 40 was 88. I got saved in 79. Do you know how excited I was as we were getting to 1988? I'm thinking, dude, we're almost there. And I remember hearing Pastor Chuck Smith saying, I'm not sure we're going to make it to 1989, you know? Do you remember those days? Like, because there's such an excitement of, we are in the last hours. But you know, it's interesting to me that the church has almost like gone to sleep since 88 in America. Well, he was supposed to come, he didn't come, so I don't think he's going to come. That's like saying, the water broke, the woman's in contractions, they kind of slowed down a little, and so we're pretty sure the baby's never going to come. Boy, are you an idiot. You know nothing about births. I mean, sometimes the lady will have a little, you know, slow down, lull. That's a good word. A little lull. And what happens after the lull, for those of you who have been present? Re-ramp up, right? And here comes the baby. I mean, and sometimes they may have two lulls. False alarm. Ooh. My question to you is, does that mean the baby is not coming just because you're in a lull? No. And we need to spiritually wake up. Jesus is coming. This might be a little lull, but the baby, you know, to say he's not coming, that's wrong. And to know if you are right with him at his coming, listen to this. He said in 1 John 2, as we end today, he says, little children, abide in him. That means remain in the Lord. So that when he appears, you would have confidence. So you won't have to shrink away from him in shame at his coming. You know, if you're staying, remaining, abiding in Jesus, and you hear about Jesus is coming again, you won't shrink away in shame when he shows up. You'll be like, all right, I've been waiting for you. And by the way, quick heart check. If when you hear about Jesus coming, you think, oh, don't come now, Lord. I still got some things I need to straighten up. Not that you would ever confess that or anything, but, you know, inwardly, you know who you are. If you're inside going, no, not yet, Lord. I just hang on. Got to straighten up a few areas. You have just identified the areas of sin in your life that you need to forsake. And you need to start abiding in him, because you do not want to shrink away in shame. When he comes, you want to be like, I was hanging out with you. And some say, how do you know what if you're abiding in Christ? Well, let's go back to don't love this world. You're in this world, but you're not what? Of this world. You have Christ as your Savior. He's your spiritual lifeboat. He's come up to you like the Coast Guard to rescue. You're in a tumultuous sea. You're in this world. You're drowning. And here comes Jesus, throws you the little life preserver, pulls you aboard, and says, you just remain where? With me. As long as you stay in that lifeboat with Jesus, you are fine. Doesn't matter what storm there is. When you've got Jesus as your Coast Guard captain, you're fine. Because he can just go like this, be still, and seas go flat. Remember that in the boat? You are totally fine if you stay with him. The only danger you have is if you jump ship and go back into the world. And by the way, do Christians do that sometimes? They're like, Lord, it's been really great hanging with you, but I got to go do something out there, and I don't think it'd be your, it's not really your scene. So you just stay here. I'm going to jump ship. And they bail. That's not abiding. If there is anything in your life that you have to say to Jesus, Jesus, you stay here while I go do this. It's not really your scene. Okay? You have just identified areas of sin. Don't go there. That's my word to you to end today. Do not go to that place, because that place is not the place that you're right with God. And in that place, if you go there, when he comes, you will be one of the ones shrinking away in shame because of your sin, instead of rejoicing in the joy of his coming. There's a big difference between the person who is right with the Lord when you talk about the Lord's return. As soon as you start talking about the Lord's return and someone's heart is right with the Lord, they're like, keep going, Pastor, man. I can't wait. You're getting me fired up. It gives me strength to keep going, because I, you know, sometimes we get tired down here. And we just need a little reminder that the birth is going to happen. I mean, he is coming again. But it won't be like the first time as a baby. The kids have asked me on Saturday night to teach them the book of Revelation. I said, man, I just did that. It took like over a year. I am not a fast teacher anymore. I want to do in-depth, verse by verse. Show us the whole thing. I'm like, that's a good book. One of my favorites. There's a lot there. I mean, meaty stuff. It fires up your faith, by the way. Because you just see, man, it's like getting preview of the birth happening. I mean, but the birth, what I'm talking about, his second return, will not be as he came as a baby in the first time. It says the sky will rent in two. It'll peel back like a curtain being torn open. And in will come the Messiah on a what? A white what? Flying horse. And following him will be myriads upon myriads, thousands of thousands, ten thousands of ten thousands is the actual how the Hebrew reads it, it's going to be what we call millions in our language of believers. And how are they following? On foot? No. This is the part my daughter Joy loves. They get their own flying horse. Anyone want a flying horse besides Phaedra and me? Right? Anyone else want a flying horse? I mean, does this sound good? Because Joy used to ask me, Daddy, are there animals in heaven? I'm like, honey, they got them, but they're upgraded. You know, because she's like, oh, is our dog going to go to heaven? And that's, you know, kids, that's first thing I know. Is the dog going to go? I said, listen, I don't know how to tell you this, but if your doggy went to heaven, they would think, you poor little thing. Because the animals up there are so upgraded. I mean, there's a creature that sits in the presence of the Lord, and on one side, it doesn't even turn its face, it says. You know why? Because it has on one side, the front, like a face of an eagle, and the face of a bear, and the face of a lion, and the face of what? A man. Has all these four faces, and it doesn't need to turn because one face can see everything on that side, and the other one, for those of you who think your mom has eyes in the back of her head, don't worry. That was just somebody saw something spiritual in Revelation and realized there are really creatures that have eyes in the back of their head. And you go, whoa. And horses that fly? And we get one? Like, I'm trying to think of names. Penelope or, I don't know, what am I going to call my flying horse, you know? Some of you already got names picked out, don't you? She's like, I got it, man. Name my horse. Is anybody excited about the idea of, now I don't really like riding the horses down here. But the idea of one that flies, I'm game, man. I watched that Avatar where the guy took the braid and stuck it onto the little dragon. And when that thing went over the hill like that and went down, I was like, my stomach, like, whoa. You know, and this is just a movie. Did anyone else besides me think, I want to do that? Just raise your hand if you really said, I would do it. Who would do it? If you could have one of them critters and just control. Give me it. I would do it. I mean, yeah, it's just a thrill seeker gene, but I'm like, and then I read the Bible and it says we get a flying horse. And I'm thinking, Avatar guys, they skimmed the story right from the good book. Somebody probably went to Sunday school and thought the same thing I thought. Flying horse is good. We got to weave this into a movie theme. Let's just make it like a critter. Stick our braid on it. You know, somebody has some creativity there. But I think they cheated. They already had the inspiration right here in the good book. You can't tell me Avatar was written before this book. This book's been out a long time. How many things do you think they've ripped off from the good book to put in movies? This line here, that line there. Do you know that if you took away this whole Bible, I could reconstruct it from just all the references in the world? This book is referred to so much in literary pieces, in movies, in all sorts of references, in secular writing, that we could reconstruct the whole Bible just from the writings in secular history. That's how quoted this book is. But it's because it has the message of hope. You're going to get eternal life. And all you have to do is stay in the boat. Stay on the Coast Guard cutter with Jesus. He's the Savior. And abide with him. And don't leave him behind. This week, if you get tempted to say, Lord, you stay here while I go do that. I don't care what it is that is that you're talking. You just identified sin. Because there is nowhere you have to say, Jesus, you stay while I go. If you're walking rightly with him, you just say, come on, let's go together. I got to go see my friend. They could really use you. You know what you gave me? They need that too. If you have to say, you stay here while I go talk to them, then you've already told me your heart has got, you're planning sin. That's not abiding. You have the Holy Ghost to abide in you. I don't have to teach you this because his Spirit already did the job. And he's a really good teacher. And you know what's so good about him? Is when I'm done here, he's not done. You can go from here, and if there's some part of it you need a little more fine-tuning understanding on, do you know that he can teach you it while you're driving home? He can teach you it when you just washing the dishes. Be washing the dishes, and the Lord will go, did you get that part? Not really. Well, let me tell you. How many believe God can teach us by his Spirit and doesn't need a person, no man, to teach you? He can actually do the job, you, God to you, direct. Anyone, raise your hand if you believe God can do that. Does he still do that? Is that popular to teach today? No. Where is it found? 1 John chapter 2, verse 27. Just make a little mental note, because he wants to be your teacher. And he uses fellows like me that he gives a gift, an anointing to teach. But guys, my gifting will only last. My gifting will only last until we see him. Bible says when we see him, we'll be made complete. And you won't need me to teach you anything about him coming, because you will have already. You will see him. You'll be like, yep, there he is. Now, if he would come right now, I would really appreciate it. Because there's nothing better for this Bible teacher than to be telling you the Lord could come. And we're in the last few minutes. I mean, we're down to the wire. I think it could be any time. I don't know when, but it could be any time. We just need to be ready at any moment. And if right now there would be a blast of a trump of an angel, and the sky would tear open and flying horses come, and we'd be caught up to meet him, you guys wouldn't be able to stand me for eternity. Be like, I told you. Wasn't I just telling you? That would be like the best way to finish this message. The Lord could come anytime. I don't know when, but now would be good. And then he comes. By the way, I'd be in heaven going, I was telling them that. That was the last preacher preaching it. And then I'll be next to another preacher going, that's what I was preaching. And then I'll hear another echo. And that's what I was preaching. Well, I was the last one. No, I was the last one. No, okay, let's time it. Lord, could you tell us when to... How many guys do you think will be preaching this on the day the Lord comes? I hope all of them. I hope there are so many men sold out and women for the Lord that say, just keep looking up. Our redemption draws nigh. Don't grow weary in well-doing. Guys, the Lord's coming soon. Are you ready? Or are you going to shrink away in shame? I hope you're ready. And if there's something holding you back from being ready, this is the time I want you to repent of it. I want you to be able to leave here ready. That you're just, okay, I'm good. Let's get you squared away. Father, as we close this time of study in your word, we pray for your Holy Ghost to help anyone here that's struggling in an area of sin, something that has crept in and is perhaps just put fetters on our fellow brother or sister. We ask that you would free them from those bonds and that you would let us to be indeed ready in our heart for the return of your Son, Lord. We know it's soon. We don't know when. But if you want to come now, I would appreciate it greatly. We could end this time seeing your Son. And Lord, we do look forward to his coming. Let us hold fast to that hope of his return, that it could do that work in us that we need. It would keep our heart pure before you. We would be ready for your coming. Strengthen us now. Strengthen our faith as we go from here. Lord, from the things what you want to teach, teach us by the anointing of your Spirit which you have given. That anointing, John said, you gave. May we hold on to that. And we pray these things in Jesus Christ, your Son's precious name. And everyone that agreed with me said, amen. Isn't it a wonderful promise, the promise of his Spirit, the promise of everlasting?
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.